And welcome to this webinar. I am Valter Minute from Toradex. I am a software engineer working at Toradex AG in Switzerland. And in this webinar, we are going to talk about the usage of asymmetrical multicore processing to create reliable and complex full-featured embedded systems. Thank you for attending, and I hope you will have an interesting hour joining us in this webinar. Let's start with an introduction. I think many of the attendees already know Toradex, but maybe for some people this is the first chance they had to get in touch with us. Toradex is a company that has been founded in 2003, so we just celebrated our 11th anniversary last month. It has been founded in Switzerland, in Orr, that is a small city close to Lucerne. During the last 11 years, the company has grown worldwide. We have Toradex companies in different countries. We have offices in the US, based in Seattle, in China, in Shanghai, India, in Bangalore, in Japan, Vietnam, and Brazil. So we cover many different countries, many different time zones. And this is also why we have different times scheduled for the webinar today. Our main focus is computer models. And we design computer models that are based on ARM processors. We are totally focused to our products, so we don't have custom designs and this kind of activities. We really are 100% focused on our product, and our approach is to have good quality and good support. And for quality, we also mean software quality. In Toradex, we have more software engineers like me than hardware engineers. This is a bit strange for a company that makes hardware. And also in terms of support, we support our hardware, of course, our software implementations, and we also provide long lifetime support for our models. We have two form factors, the Colby form factor, that is the original form factor at Toradex, and the Apalis form factor that is more recent and provides some additional interfaces like PCI Express, CDLATA, HDMI, and so on. You can find more information about our company and our products on our website, so I'm not wasting any more time in this webinar talking about this, and just move to the technical content. In this webinar, we are talking about the asymmetrical multicore architecture, and in particular, we are focusing on the vibrate processor from Freescale. We will compare the vibrate approach to the, let's call it, traditional approach of having separate processors, and we will also dig deep into the implementation details. So we will discuss how this asymmetrical multicore stuff is implemented in the vibrate and how you can use it from the different operating system software libraries we can provide. At the end, we are going also to show a nice video of a demo that maybe some people here already have seen at the Embedded World in Nuremberg last year. So let's start with the vibrate. Vibrate is from Freescale. If you look at the Freescale website, vibrate is a bit hidden between the i.mx application processor family and the Kinetis microcontroller family. I said it's sort of hidden because it's a smaller family and really sits in between, because we have different SKUs for the vibrate and three subfamilies. The VF300 something family, it's really close to a microcontroller. We don't have any external memory in the interface, any DDR memory interface, so the amount of memory you can use for your application is quite limited. On the other side, we have a Cortex A5 core, So it's quite a powerful processor. We have the VF500 something family, and this is the family we use on our VF50 module. We also have a single core processor, a Cortex-A5, but we have a DDR interface, so we can have a good amount of external memory and we can run a full-featured operating system like Linux or Windows CE. Those are the operating systems we currently support on this family. And then we have the VF600 family. This family is the family that actually implements the multi-core architecture. It provided Cortex-A5 and the Cortex-M4 cores in the same silicon. It also has the DDR interface, so it can also run Linux and Windows CE or any full-feature operating system you can port on an ARM processor. In this presentation, we are talking about the feature of the VF600 family, so our VF61 module that you can see in the picture in this slide. But before we start talking about the hardware, let's start with a very generic question. So can you think about something that fits this definition? You can sleep on it and you can clean your teeth using it. I will give you 10 seconds to figure out an answer. Okay, I think the answer is not very surprising because we can use a bed and a toothbrush. I mean, the question was very easy and also the answer was pretty clear, but what is sometimes disappointing is that people try to figure out just a single thing as an answer. And sometimes you don't have a single thing that really fits such different needs. A single object that can perform two very different tasks. This happens also in on embedded devices. Today, embedded devices have very complex and very mixed requirements. We need to provide a rich user interface many times. We also need, or alternatively, we need to provide also many connectivity features supporting different networking protocols, integrating into complex network solution for what is now called the Internet of Things. We also, developers want to use high-level tools to develop their software to be more productive. But on the other side, on our embedded devices, we still have some requirement in terms of real-time response time and also in terms of reliability and security of our system. So since we have so different requirements, trying to use a single tool to satisfy all those requirements is not always the right thing to do. Sometimes mixing different tools and different technologies can really lead to better results, to a system that is more reliable, that is more performant, and maybe it's even cheaper than a system designed around a single technology and a single tool. If we think about the ARM product lineup, we can see two different families. We have the Cortex-A family, that is that are a application processor, so they are designed to run a full-featured operating system. They provide connectivity features. Many of them provide also graphic controllers integrated inside the silicon. We have high performances up to a couple of gigahertz today. We have internal caches, floating point processing unit, additional instruction set like Neon that are really useful for multimedia and this kind of activities. On the other side, we have the Cortex-M and also the Cortex-R families that are microcontrollers that are suitable to run usually a small real-time operating system or just some firmware, and they fit quite well requirement for low-cost devices and also low-power devices. So also from ARM, we have two different solutions and maybe they are targeting different kinds of problems. If we move on the software side, we also have many different operating systems, and on one side we have full-featured operating system. The most commonly used is Linux nowadays, and in Linux we have a very large set of features ranging again from connectivity to user interface to multimedia, and also support for many different industrial protocols like CAN bus and many others. Using Linux definitely has some advantages in terms of hardware support. Also Freescale provides support for the Vibrate out of the box. We have a very large code base. The kernel itself is a few million lines of code nowadays, and inside this code base we have many drivers that we can immediately reuse to support our hardware. Both the devices integrated inside our SoC and also external devices like, for example, Wi-Fi adapters or whatever. Linux, as many modern full-featured operating system, has a very strong separation between kernel mode and user mode. So we have all the hardware access performed in kernel mode, or most of it, and in user mode we have applications that use an API to access the operating system features. In Linux we can have multiple processes running, so our system can perform multiple activities at the same time, and we can clearly split those tasks into different processes and also reuse some software components, like for example a web server to provide a configuration remote UI or whatever. So Linux fit quite well the full feature operating system definition. On the other side we have a small operating system that we call real-time operating systems. There are some full features real-time operating system like Windows CE or QNX, but in this slide we are really focusing on the small operating system that can run on for example Cortex-M4 architectures. Those systems are designed to have minimal and deterministic latencies. If you need to do real-time, you need that your system is able to react fast, quickly to external events like interrupts, but and this is even more important, is that this reaction time is really deterministic, so you can measure it and you are sure that it's always respected. To have this kind of performances, you really need to tightly integrate the application and the operating system itself. So usually on this kind of operating system you don't have any kind of protection between the hardware and the application. The application many times really accesses directly the hardware. Silicon vendors usually provide some libraries to, let's say, simplify the hardware access. Also Freescale is doing this. It's also providing some tools like Processor Expert to really simplify the development of the firmware code. But anyway, in this system you have a very tight integration between the hardware, the operating system, and the application. This leads to better real-time performances compared, for example, to Linux. Also to a lower complexity in the operating system and reduced memory footprint. But on the other side, we lose many of the features we are used to have on Linux or Windows or whatever full-featured operating system we are using on devices. And also, there are many different RT operating systems, and the degree of hardware support or the amount of code you can find under different licenses for this kind of operating system is very small compared to Linux. So also on the software side we have two very different tools that we can use to implement different things. If we talk about multicore, the concept of multicore is basically putting inside the same silicon different multiple CPUs. Probably most of the people that are attending this webinar right now are using a multicore device if you're using a PC, but even if you're using a smartphone or a tablet to attend the webinar, you are probably using a multicore device. But most, if not all, those devices nowadays are using symmetrical multicore. So we have multiple instances of the same core, so same CPU architecture, and an operating system, it may be Windows, it may be Android, it may be Linux, is using those cores to split the different tasks, and having exactly the same architecture really makes this activity quite simple. All the cores can run all the software we have on our system. We have a slightly different approach from ARM with the big little architecture. Here we have different cores, but different cores of the same family, so cores that can really run the same instruction set. In this case, we are using some cores or others depending on the processing power requirements and also on the power consumption requirement. But we are still using symmetric multicore in this scenario. Asymmetric multicore is a bit different because we have multiple cores inside the same silicon, but those cores are not able to execute the same instruction set. So we have really different machines inside the same silicon. This is a different approach, as I said, but this approach can be very useful in some scenarios. So any technical presentation needs to have an architecture diagram. So you are getting your share of architecture diagram in this slide. This slide came directly from Freescale, and this is the architecture of the Vibrant VF600 processors. As you can see in green here, we have the two cores. We have a Cortex A5 that can run up to 500 megahertz. This is the speed we have on our VF61 module, and the Cortex M4 that runs at up to 167 megahertz. Both CPUs have a floating point unit, but this is the only similarity. They are really different. They run the ARM instruction set, but different versions, and of course the A5 is an application processor and the M4 is a microcontroller. But those two cores are inside the same silicon, and in this silicon you can find different peripheral devices like timers, like display controller, like audio interfaces, like some communication interfaces like Ethernet, also CAN bus, serial ports, I2C, SPI, USB. We have some analog to digital converters, some digital to analog converters, and so on. As you can see, the set of peripheral devices we have on the Vibrate, it's quite complete and fits quite well many industrial device or automotive device and this kind of stuff. We have also some external interfaces for DDR memory, for flash memory, and so on. The interesting part is that both cores can access all those devices. So before we started the webinar, someone was asking about the memory map. Actually, both cores can access everything. The only limitation that there is that the DDR controller has two memory banks. It can control, if I am not remembering wrong, up to 1 gigabyte of memory. And the M4 can access only the first bank, so up to 512 meg. Actually, on our VF61 module, we have 256 megabytes of RAM, so really this is not a limitation. Both core can really access everything inside the system, and they really share the internal bus, and there are no physical limitation about what they can access. In other asymmetrical multicore architecture, you may have this kind of limitation. On the vibrate, you don't. We are going to see later in the webinar that this is an advantage and also something we have to care about when we design our software. But really, in terms of accessing devices and external memory, we have no limitation between the two cores. Okay, so I think some people attending the webinar were wondering, okay, but I have been doing asymmetrical multicore since many years, maybe. Before joining Toradex, I've been working as a consultant for many years, and I've been working on many projects when we were using different kind of processors. Why this is not asymmetrical multicore? Because those processors were not inside the same silicon. So we were using an application processor that was running the full-featured operating system, Linux, Windows CE, or Windows even, and an external microcontroller that was running usually some custom firmware or, in some cases, some small real-time operating system. But being two different silicon parts had some disadvantages. And in my experience, and maybe some of the people attending will recognize also their own experience here, managing the communication between the two core has always been a major pain point in the project, because you have to allocate some resources on the external microcontroller to manage a communication link. And in most of the cases I've been working on, it was a serial communication link like a UART or an SPI port. And this reduces the capabilities of this processor, because managing this kind of link, and mostly when this link needs some good transfer rate, really can require a good amount of the processing power of a microcontroller. And anyway, even if the managing the link was not so complicated, you still need some additional signals, for example, to generate an interrupt on the other processor. And the amount of memory you have on the external microcontroller is usually quite limited. For some projects, this was not a big issue. For other projects where the application processor and the external processor needed to share a big amount of information, this was quite an issue, because you need to buffer this information and to consider the limited amount of memory you usually have on a standalone microcontroller. And another limitation you have is that you cannot share any device. They have different external buses, or no external bus, as usually happens with the microcontroller. So you cannot really share any device between the two processors. With the vibrate, what are the advantages of the vibrate architecture? On vibrate, we have a very fast communication channel. We can just share memory, so we don't have to transfer any data. We can really have the data already in place and access it from the two cores. If we need to, let's say, get the attention of the other processor, we can directly generate an interrupt on it. So really no faster way to communicate with another processor. We don't need any additional hardware. It's already there. It's already in the silicon. Obviously, when we share some resources, sharing is great, because you don't have to copy or transfer them. But on the other side, you have to be careful about accessing them in the right way and not having someone writing and someone reading at the same time, and maybe not getting coherent data. Inside of Vibrate, we have some hardware semaphores that can help us to synchronize the access to shared resources. Also, having shared device will allow you to have great flexibility in design. As Toradex, in the past, we never designed a module with an external microcontroller on it. Why? Because you have to decide in advance which devices you want to use on one processor or the other. And this is quite limiting for design. mostly for modules, we may have decided to use like 2 UARTs for the Stellar microcontroller and just one from the full-featured operating system. And then some customer can ask, oh, I need to use a serial port on Linux to control, for example, an external GPRS modem. And I also need another one for a console. And so this is a hardware limitation, no way to do it. With the FireBrid, you can really decide from software which devices you want to use from the A5 and which one you want to use from the M4. And you can even change this during your design. In my previous experience, it happened sometime that we decided to use some device from the application processor and then realize that the response time from the full-featured operating system were not good enough to really use this device. So we had to redesign the hardware, maybe change the standard microprocessor to be able to, for example, manage CAN bus and move part of the software implementation on this other architecture. And as you know, changing the software is painful, but changing the hardware is really, really painful. And so in the FireBrid, you still have to modify your software, of course, if you take such a decision, but you will not have to redesign your hardware. And another point that it may look like a minor point, but also in my experience has always been a pain point in designs, was updating the software on the second processor. You needed to be sure that the processor was doing nothing. You have to put it in some spatial condition. You had to transfer the firmware, and of course you have to write it directly to the flash because you didn't have enough RAM to store it. And this leads to some dangerous situation, like being powered down in the middle of an upgrade and not be able to do anything on the external core. On the FireBrid, it's pretty easy. Let's call it firmware for the M4, it's in memory. So you have just to load it from a file or whatever, and upgrading it really means load a different file. Of course, we don't want to hide this. There are also some disadvantages. One potential disadvantage from the hardware side is that when you start to design something, maybe the FireBrid is not providing all the peripheral devices you may want to use. If you can select an application processor and an external microcontroller, then you have more choices and more flexibility in having some additional external device. As I said before, the design is more rigid, so changing it during the project is going to be very, very complicated and very, very expensive. But you may have a wider range of opportunities. Even if sometime in practice that's not so true, because maybe using a different family of microcontroller also means learning different tools, learning different languages, and so on, so it's not so convenient. Another point where the FireBrid can have some disadvantages is when you have to certify your code. If you have a custom firmware, it may be a few hundred or few thousand lines of code. You can use automatic tools to verify, for example, that it's compliant to the MISRA specification or whatever specification is used in your specific industry. On the FireBrid, you can do this on the core running on the M4, but it may not be so easy to convince the certification authority that actually you are running it on a separate core, and sometimes for certification purposes, being inside the same silicon means having to certify everything. And for some kind of certification, for example, you cannot do this using Linux or other full-featured operating systems. So in this scenario, you have to check if the FireBrid can really fit your. It may fit your requirement, but it may generate some issues about certification. So this is a warning we give you. You have to check this in advance. Of course, if the vibrate fits, you can still use the VF50 module and have an external microcontroller with the most critical features implemented there and having just this firmware certified. So now let's move a bit deeper into the implementation details. As I already said, the A5 and M4 share the same, in the slide we say share memory, actually they share the data bus and address buses, so they can really access the same internal and external devices. Each core can generate an interrupt on the other one. We have four interrupts that we can use, and we can decide how many interrupts are received on the M4, how many on the A5. For each hardware interrupt, actually, we can decide on which core the interrupt is generated. So one step you have to do for sure when you design your software is to initialize, they call it the miscellaneous system controller, and use it to sort of multiplex the interrupt sources, say, okay, I want this interrupt to be generated on the A5, this one on the M4, even an interrupt generated on both. We will talk about the hardware semaphores that can be really used to synchronize the two cores when it's needed. And then also we will see some APIs that Freescale provides and that can really simplify the communication between the two cores. Okay, first thing you have to do for sure is to boot the M4. On Vibrate we have different SKUs and we have some let's say variation of the Vibrate that boot from the M4 and other from the A5. On our model we use only processor that boot first the A5 processor. So when you boot the A5 it may be the full operating system or just the bootloader. Then you have to boot the M4. The steps you have to do to boot the M4 are, first of all, you have to load its firmware in memory. It has no internal flash memory, so you really need to find some RAM. It may be the internal RAM or the DDR. The M4 can access both. You have to load this firmware in memory. Of course, when you build the firmware, you have to configure it for that specific memory range. In Linux, for example, the most common approaches are to use the internal memory. The Vibrate, the VF61, has 512 kilobytes of internal memory that is not currently used by Linux or even by Windows CE. So here you can fit the firmware. Or you can limit the amount of memory used by the, like, let's call it main operating system, and reserve an area for the firmware. In Linux, for example, you have the mem command line option for the kernel. So if you state like mem 128, you are using only half of the physical memory for Linux, and the rest of the memory is not touched by Linux itself, and so you can use it for the firmware, and also you can use it as shared memory between the two cores. From Linux you can still map it and access it. Once you have defined your memory layout and loaded your firmware, you have to load the boot address into one of the registers of the system reset controller. So this is sort of jump address for the M4. It's going to start the execution from this address. And another register allows you to pass a 32-bit value to the second core. So this value may be the address of some shared data, or you can define some flags that change the behavior of the firmware depending on something, whatever you want. As soon as you have loaded the firmware in memory and initialized the register, you can just enable the clock of the M4 and it's going to start its execution. Actually, Freescale provides a tool named MQX Boot MQX, because this is a real-time operating system from Freescale that they support, that can be used to perform this operation. It's not really tied to MQX, so you can really boot a totally different operating system. And of course, Freescale provide the full source code of this small tool, so you can even take this source code and integrate the same feature inside your application. As we already stated multiple times, the two cores share the same memory, but they usually access the memory in a different way. When we use the A5 and we run Linux or another operating system, we usually have the MMU enabled. This means that we are not using the physical address of to access the memory. We are using a virtual address that is then remapped to the physical one, and also that we may have some caching in between. So if we need to write some information that should be accessible from the N4, first of all, we have to use the right address. So we probably need to map this physical address into a virtual address that we can use, for example, from a Linux application. And also, we have to ensure that we are not using caching on this address range, or if we are using caching, we need to flush the cache before having the M4 accessing this data. On the M4, we don't have this kind of issues because we don't have an MMU, and we don't have this kind of remapping of addresses. On the other side, usually when we build the firmware code for the M4, this code is really built to run from a specific memory address, so we cannot relocate the firmware as we can do with a regular, for example, Linux executable file. So those are two things you have to take care about when you implement your firmware and your application code on the other side. Of course, for some people this kind of information is quite basic, but I suppose that many people will approach this architecture having some experience only on one side. For example, you have been developing for a long time on a microcontroller, and then MMU and cache may be a new concept for you. Or on the other side, you are used to work on a high-level operating system, so you don't care too much about the real memory addresses of your stuff. And you have to deal with this kind of things if you want to integrate two different things. We already talked about interrupts. We say that both cores can generate an interrupt on the other core, or even on itself, but usually this is not so useful. We have an interrupt router that is part of the miscellaneous system control management, or whatever this acronym means, unit, that can be used to route the different interrupts, and we have up to four dedicated interrupts that are dedicated for inter-processor communication. So when we design our software, we can really have for example, the Linux application generating an interrupt on the M4 to start something or to check, to force some operations, and obviously also vice versa. IPS semaphores are quite unique hardware unit. We have 16 semaphores that we can use to synchronize access to shared resources. Of course, if you develop some multi-thread or application, one of the first issues you will have to deal with is synchronizing the access to shared resources. If you are just working on a single operating system, operating system provides some kind of primitives to synchronize different threads or different processes. In Linux, you have semaphores, you have queues, depending if you are in the kernel or in user mode. But here in the Vibrate, we are running two different operating systems on two different course. And so synchronizing using just pure software logic is not so easy. The easiest way is to use some hardware feature. The semaphores are implemented in hardware. You can just lock the semaphore, and only one CPU can do this at any instant in time. It's granted that even if they try to access it at the same clock tick, only one of them will really get the ownership of the semaphore. And so as soon as you get the ownership of the semaphore, you are sure that the other core is not accessing the resource that the semaphore is protecting. I mean, you are sure unless you put some bugs in your code, of course, but it's a reasonable grant. If you try to access a semaphore and it's used, you can retry, but the more efficient way is just to let the semaphore generate an interrupt as soon as it's released. So, for example, if we have a shared memory buffer, we can have the A5 locking the semaphore, writing the data, releasing the semaphore. The M4 core can try to lock the semaphore. If the semaphore is free, then it can lock the memory area and access the data and be sure that the A5 is not going to change it in that specific moment, and then release the semaphore, of course. If the semaphore is locked, it means that the A5 is updating the data, and so the M4 can just wait for an interrupt and perform other activities, and as soon as it receives the interrupt, it can try to lock the semaphore again. There is no grant about the order. So if both processors are trying to lock the semaphore at very high frequency, it's not granted if it's 50% A5, 50% M4, or 100% A5, or 100% M4. You cannot really rely on any kind of arbitration logic on this. The processor that's trying to access the semaphore, and when the semaphore is free, is going to get it. Another important thing is that this kind of semaphore are not implemented using a counter. This usually happens on a high-level operating system. You lock the semaphore, and then you enter another function, you lock it again, and then you have to release it twice before it's effectively released. On hardware semaphore, we don't have any counter, so as soon as you release the semaphore, it's going to be released, even if you try to lock it like 20 times. To simplify communication, Freescale introduced a library named MCC. In MCC, we have a slightly different concept. In MCC, we talk about endpoints. You can think about the endpoint as an TCP/IP endpoint. In TCP/IP, you have an IP address and the port. This is more or less the same with the MCC endpoints. In MCC, you have an address for the core. It's not as complex as an IP address because we have just two. So 0 is the A5 and 1 is the M4. And then on the Linux implementation, we can have multiple processes, and each process can be a node. So it's a sort of sub-address, and each node can use different ports. So we can have multiple communication channels between the A5 and the M4. And this can make sense because, for example, you can have a channel from the A5 to the M4 to send commands, another channel to get replies to those commands, and another one, for example, to get notifications about, I don't know, errors or other issues you may have. Between those endpoints, you can transfer messages. A message can be up to 1 kilobyte. It's not that big. Yeah, it's usually big enough to transfer some meaningful information. If 1 kilobyte is not enough, nothing prevents you from putting a pointer inside this message that references some additional data. When you build the MCC library, you have to define the maximum number of endpoints and maximum number of messages you want to have in between the different endpoints. All the memory used by MCC, at least if you don't modify the free scale provided implementation, is inside the internal memory. And all the data structure are allocated statically. This may lead to some, let's say, waste of resources because you need to over-dimension your queues and everything. But on the other side, it's much more safer because you are not allocating anything at runtime, so you don't risk to run into an out-of-memory situation or something like this. Okay, sorry, I will move back to the other slide, just an ordering mistake on my side. This is the MCC API. So with MCC, you can initialize and destroy the library, so basically means allocate the memory, the internal memory, and release it. And you can also get some information about the number of endpoints you have, the number of ports, whatever number of maximum number of messages you may have between the different endpoints. The first operation you have to do in MCC is to create an endpoint. So as soon as you create an endpoint, you have a sort of pipe that you can use to communicate. When you no longer need it, you can destroy it. Over the endpoint, you can send messages. Sending is just copying the information into the message. When you receive the message, you can have two different behaviors. You can just get access to the memory where the message is stored. It's more efficient, but of course, if the application is sending other messages, this memory can be reused, or you can just perform a copy of the message, so you have a safe copy of its contents, and this is not going to be changed at any time. You can obviously check if there are some messages available on a specific endpoint, and if you receive the message performing a copy, you can release the buffer that has been allocated by MCC to store the message. So as you can see, the API, it's quite easy and quite simple. You can even conceptually remap it to the socket API. It's, of course, it's the function name stuff is different, but you can think about the endpoint as a sort of socket, and then you can send and receive messages on it. Of course, we are talking about messages between the two cores in the same silicon, so you don't have all the network latencies or potential issues you have with real sockets. What we have in terms of software support. Right now, we have support for Linux, and Linux already supports the multi-core architecture, so you can already implement a solution using the Linux BSP we provide. Freescale support is MQX. MQX is a free operating system, free as beer and free as speech. The only restriction on MQX is that you need to use it on a Freescale processor. With the help of one of our partner, Antmicro, we ported ECOS on the M4 core. We choose to support ECOS because ECOS provides a sort of compatibility layer for POSIX, so for people that have experience on Linux, the ECOS API may be not so different, and also for Micro ITRON, that is another popular API in the real-time operating system field. Antmicro is one of the Toradex partners. We just launched our partner website a few days ago. So if you are looking for some companies that can support you in implementing your software solution or designing your hardware to use the Toradex modules, you can look at this session of our website. We port Windows Embedded Compact on the Vibrid. At the moment we are not yet supporting the multi-core stuff, but this is something we have in our roadmap. We think that this feature is more important on Linux, because Linux is not a hard real-time operating system itself. So if you need to do something hard real-time on Linux, you can really leverage this architecture. Windows Embedded Compact is hard real-time itself, so this can satisfy some of the scenarios you can implement using the asymmetrical multicore architecture, but still there are some scenarios where having a separate processor is definitely useful. So this is why we plan also to support this stuff on Windows Embedded Compact. At the moment you can boot the M4 directly from Linux invoking the MQX boot tool, or even from the bootloader. So if you need that, the M4 is operating quite early in the device lifetime, you can boot it from U-boot. Antmicro also developed a software emulator of the ARM architecture named Emulate, and using Emulate you can run your code in a virtual environment and debug both cores at the same time. This is the API that we have already seen. So what we have to do to have Linux or any other full-featured operating system and real-time operating system cooperate? We can implement all the let's say high-level feature on the A5 using, for example, Linux, and define which real-time real-time features we need to implement on the M4. We can use the MCC library if the messaging implementation fits our architecture, or we can define our own communication implementation. And of course we have to decide which devices are going to be used by the A5, which devices can be used by the M4. Of course we can change this during the project, but planning it in advance usually shortens the development time. I see that there are some questions popping up, but just quickly checking them, I think we can answer them at the end. In terms of software support, we support Open Embedded on the Vibrid, and the multi-core communication features can be quite easily integrated in our images or in your own build environment. We already talked about ECOS. It's a free operating system. It has been developed by a couple of companies, but it's also supported by a quite good community of developers. In terms of feature, we have a scheduler, so we can have multiple tasks running with real-time response times. We have an hardware abstraction layer, so we have a sort of degree of portability of our code between the different architecture. For example, if you need to access GPIO, you have an API, so you don't need to dig deep into the specific GPIO controller you want to use. It supports C and C++ using also part of the standard libraries. It also supports floating point, and this is useful because we have floating point on the M4 core inside the Vibrid. On ECOS, you have some graphic tools that allow you to configure the operating system, so you can select which features you want to support. Of course, removing some features can save some memory footprint, and also supports the compatibility layers I've been talking before, POSIX and MicroITron. That can be useful if you already have some experience on Linux or on other micro iTron implementation and you want to move to the hybrid. So to summarize the point of this webinar, the idea is that if you need to solve different problems, you need to use the right tools. And you don't have to force yourself to use a single tool and try to make it fit the different requirement. The vibrate architecture really fits this philosophy. We have different cores, we can run different operating systems, and then we can split the features and implement them in the, let's say, right way on the different core and provide an embedded system that is both complex, providing a lot of feature to the end customer, but also reliable and able to grant real-time response time. Okay, let's move to the demo and then we can provide the some answer, I hope. This is a demo we built for the embedded world in Nuremberg in February. We use some off-the-shelf hardware. It's a 2D plotter kit. You can buy it on the internet for like $200. It has just some stepper motors and some mechanics to control the pen. Honestly, we had to hack it a little bit to make it a bit more, let's say, a bit less shaky. But it's really something you can find on the internet for a very low price. And we use the VF61 module with the vibrate on it, and one of our cardboard, that's the Iris. We connected them. And as you can see in this picture, on the A5 we have Linux running, a very nice graphic UI implemented using the Qt library. And on the M4 we have some custom firmware that is processing G code is a language used for plotters and 3D printers that basically defines some movement operation. So from the UI you can select some graphic design and then you can start to plot it on the plotter. What happens? The application loads the G code in RAM, send the command to the plotter, say okay, start drawing this, and the data is already in memory. Of course, I mean, for this kind of implementation we didn't need super strict real-time performances and whatever, but it's just a sample showing how you can have motor control on one side, you can have a really nice looking UI on the other side, and they can share quite a good amount of information without having to serialize it over a slow serial link. Here you can see some details about the stepper motors, about the pen, and about the motor controllers, but those are really dumb motor controls, so you can just use some GPIOs to control them. And this is the second architecture diagram of the webinar. Sorry for this. This is the software architecture. So you have on one side Linux and the Qt application that using the MCC library. The MCC library is split between a user mode library and the kernel module because it has to access some hardware like the semaphores. The application on the other side is running on top of ECOS. Actually on ECOS you really link together the application and the operating system. There is no user mode and kernel mode hard separation in ECOS, so we just have a library to implement MCC. And on ECOS we implemented the same MCC API you have on Linux. We share some memory with the G code, and then we use some messages to start plotting, to stop it, and from the M4 to the A5 to report about the status. So on the application you can see we plotted like 20% of your drawing. This is the information about the software. I already talked about this. Here you can find some interesting links on our developer website. From the first link you can see an article describing the application, and you can also have instruction about how to build it on your system. And you can download the full source code of the Qt application, of the ECOS implementation, and everything. If you want to learn something more about ECOS and in specifically about our about the implementation that Ant Micro ported on the VF61, you can use the second link. And the third and fourth link are two articles we wrote for embeddedcomputing.com that introduce the multi-core architecture and also provide a more, let's say, descriptive introduction about our demo. So if after the webinar you want to dig deep into this, you can use these links. And now I'm going to show a video that shows the plotter in action, so you can really see that at the end we implemented this feature. Okay, it's a short 1 minute video that shows the plotter in action. I think during the video I can maybe start to reply to some questions because we are running a bit late. From the post by Stefan, Linux image from TimeSys was used. As they say in German, Jein, means yes and no. Actually, the initial support from for the Vibrate was provided through TimeSys. So Freescale was providing support through TimeSys for the Vibrate. We used that code as the, let's say, start point for our implementation, and also TimeSys were providing was providing an MCC implementation. We didn't change all the MCC implementation. I think we ported it to ECOS only. We changed quite a lot of the kernel mode code, adding new drivers, changing some existing ones. So right now we have our own version of the kernel for the Vibrate, and part of it has already been merged into the mainline kernel. So we are maintaining our own version. It's based on TimeSys work, but we added many features, and also some of this stuff has been ported back into the TimeSys code base. The image from Toradex comes with MCC. I think the answer is yes, but I'm not 100% sure about this. So if you can follow up with an email, I will collect more detailed information. If it's not already there, we for sure provide an additional layer for open embedded, so integrating this into the image is quite easy. Any method to flash the image to internal memory? If we are talking about the Linux image, you can flash the image from U-boot from an SD card, or we have serial recovery mode. You don't need to flash anything for the M4 because the code is loaded into memory. It's just a file you have on the Linux file system. So you really don't need to flash the firmware like you do on a traditional microcontroller. Any tip to run M4 core primarily? But it's set up A5 only when A5 is needed. Actually, the boot order, it's hard-coded. So really, there's no way to boot the M4 first on our modules. There are some Vibrate SKUs from Freescale that allow you to do this. But on our module, we decided to use the A5 as the first processor booting. You can, this is a bit tricky, you can suspend the A5 and keep the M4 running, but the problem is that usually when you suspend the A5, you also put the DDR in self-refresh mode. So if you're running your code from the DDR, or you are using the DDR to share some information, this can be a bit tricky. So I mean, it may be done, but it's not running as it is out of the box. Is emulate a physical tool debugger? No, it's just software emulation, as Danny already said. Any news of using SPI from ECOS? I did not receive from Antmicro. You can follow up with an email. Actually, the ECOS porting is provided as it is on our website. You can contact Antmicro to have additional implementation performed on the on ECOS. Both the M4, A5 and M4 are part of the same chip silicon or two chips. No, they are really part of the same silicon. That's why they can share memory and devices. Could you suggest applications specific to only this architecture? I think there are no really applications for where this that can be implemented only with this architecture. You may use an FPGA, you may use an external processor, and so on. I think this architecture is not enabling totally new and totally different implementations. But on the other side, I think it can be quite useful to simplify the implementation of many existing scenarios. Every time you have an external processor, I will look into your implementation and consider if it's worth. If you already have something working, usually you don't want to re-implement it. But if you have a new design and you are thinking about implementing it with two separate processors, maybe considering also the vibrid as an alternative can make sense. Of course, there are some restrictions, like for example, the A5 is a single core, it's running at 500 megahertz. You will be surprised by the performances of the A5. It's quite efficient in terms of power consumption, but also of processing power. But of course, it's 500 megahertz, so you cannot expect it to do, like for example, real-time video compression or full HD video playback, this kind of stuff. So at the moment, this can be a limitation for some scenarios. But if you're thinking about two different processors, give an eye to the vibrate, then maybe we can discuss this. And in many scenarios, I think it fits the scenario and really simplify your implementation. Yeah, the point is there is one point of failure here if things go wrong. Yes and no. For example, if the Linux kernel crashes on the A5, the M4 keeps running. So if you implement a sort of keep alive mechanism between the two, you can reset the system, for example, if this happens. So you still have some degree of control. Of course, if the processor is broken or, for example, the clock is not running correctly or whatever, both cores are not running. But also in separate core scenarios, many times if one of the two cores is not running, the only thing you can do is reset the system. So yeah, theoretically, it may be an issue in practice. Is this successful security compromise in case of web application? I don't think so. If you have a bug in your web application that allows you to run some code that is not supposed to run on the application processor, having the secondary processor in the same silicon or having it accessible outside really doesn't change anything. If you can run some code, if you have to vibrate, then you have to find a way to understand where the M4 firmware is and do something nasty there. If you have an external processor, you have to figure out how do they communicate and do something nasty over the communication link. So it really doesn't change the potential issue. Can I load the database locally here? You can do it quite easily on Linux. You can extract data from the database and maybe put it in a more simplified format and store it in memory and share it with the M4. SQLite is supported on Linux. I think there are no porting for like ECOS because there you don't have a file system. So if you need to use a feature like a database, it makes sense to have it on Linux and to share the data with the M4. Okay, if there are no more questions, we are already 10 minutes over our timing. It's not an issue on my side, but I don't want to keep people busy for too long. So thank you very much for... sorry, there is a question coming from Daniel. Does the vibrate possess two individual core or processor to perform task of display and provided position data to step drive? Yeah, this is what's happening in the demo. In the demo, we have a VF, the A5 core driving the user interface and the M4 controlling the stepper motors. Okay, if there are no more questions, thank you very much for attending, and depending on your time zone, have a good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, or even good night to Daniel that is based in Seattle. Thank you so much for attending, and if you have additional questions or you need some more information about the Vibrid or any other product in our product lineup, you can easily contact our office closer to you or just send a request on the support webpage on our website. On our developer website, you can find lots of information also about this specific topic, but about all our hardware and software products. Thank you very much for attending, and see you at the next webinar. Bye.